100 years ago, astronomers figured out that the universe hadn't always been the same size. More specifically, it's getting bigger. But if you ask a bunch of astronomers how fast the universe is getting bigger, you won't get a single satisfying answer. Estimates tend to hover around two different values. And it's such a huge issue, some people call it the crisis in cosmology. So when the shiny new James Webb Space Telescope launched in 2021, there were hopes that the crisis would be resolved. But the JWST may have actually made it worse, leading to an even bigger mystery that might reveal brand new physics at work. Our story starts in 1929, when American astronomer Edwin Hubble published a paper announcing that a bunch of galaxies in the night sky are moving away from us. In other words, the universe was expanding, not the galaxies themselves, but the space between them. The rate of that expansion has varied over time, and astronomers refer to the current rate of expansion as the Hubble constant, H-naught. Hubble even provided us with an estimate for H-naught, 530 kilometers per second per megaparsec, which doesn't mean a whole lot to someone who isn't an astronomer, so let's take a moment to break it down. A megaparsec is a unit of distance. One megaparsec is about 3 million light years, or 31 quintillion kilometers. For context, the distance between the Milky Way and Andromeda, the next major galaxy over, is about 0.8 megaparsecs, and the entire observable universe is about 30,000 megaparsecs wide. So if the value for H-naught were really 530, it'd mean that a galaxy that's 1 megaparsec away from us would be flying away from us at a speed of 530 kilometers a second. A galaxy that's 2 megaparsecs away would be moving away from us at 1,060 kilometers a second, and so on. But over the years, it turned out Hubble's estimate was off. Like, way off. Thanks to better telescopes and better data sets, we know H-naught is really somewhere around 70 kilometers per second per megaparsec. But the exact value? That's where the problem lies. And we've got a cosmological crisis on our hands because different groups are trying to measure H-naught using different methods. They should all give the same answer, but right now, they simply aren't. And since the problem surrounds the Hubble constant, some call it the Hubble tension. There are two main camps that are in conflict here. Let's call them the CMB camp and the distance ladder camp, for reasons that we'll make clear. The CMB camp says H-naught is about 67. The distance ladder camp claims it's about 73. Compared to 500, that doesn't sound like a big difference at all. But it is when you realize the error bars don't overlap. That's a fancy way of saying that both camps have rigorously checked all the possible sources of random error and noise in their measurements and strongly believe their number is basically correct. For instance, the CMB crew quote their value for H-naught as 67.4 plus or minus 0.5, which means they're confident that their real final value is somewhere between 66.9 and 67.9. But different distance ladder teams quote their number as being around 73 plus or minus about 1. And 73 minus 1 is still larger than 67.9. Both camps are claiming that random errors alone can't explain the difference between their numbers. Hence, a crisis in cosmology. Which, well, okay, maybe you wouldn't quite call this a crisis, but trust me when I say that this is high drama in astrophysics circles. Because the stakes are high, the Hubble constant is crucial for understanding how old the universe is, how fast it expanded in the past, and what the expansion will look like in the future. The biggest of big picture stuff. And every observation we make builds on the others. So if the story we're telling about the universe's expansion isn't consistent, we might need to doubt the conclusions we've made in other areas of astronomy. Having two conflicting H-naught values also makes it harder to look for new physics, like trying to solve the long-standing mysteries of both dark matter and dark energy, which our universe seems to be full of. But before we get into how these camps got their different H-naught values, we've got to pay some bills.
Thanks to Brilliant for supporting this SciShow video. One of the best things about SciShow and Brilliant is that you can access them anywhere with an internet connection. That's a lot of places you could be learning. Like, you could build knowledge around large language models while your kid's over there building a sandcastle. Or you could gain an understanding of Bayes' theorem while you're cooling down from your gains in the gym. Brilliant makes it easy to learn right on your phone with lessons you can complete whenever and wherever you feel like it. You can learn on the go at brilliant.org/scishow, the QR code on the screen, or at the link in the description. You'll get 20% off an annual premium Brilliant subscription and the first 30 days for free.
So, what exactly are the two camps and the two techniques they're using to calculate H-naught? For the distance ladder teams, the idea is to look right at galaxies a few megaparsecs away and measure their distance and speed. But getting accurate distance and speeds for objects that far away is easier said than done. So astronomers start with more reliable distance calculations from our cosmic backyard. Those are the bottom rungs of the so-called ladder, and then use those rungs to help you work out distance farther away. The next rungs up on the ladder are standard candles, things that always shine with the same intensity no matter how far away they are. So in theory, all you have to do to calculate their distance is to measure how bright they appear to be. You also have to know precisely how these objects function to know how bright they should be, which is also easier said than done. For standard candles, astronomers tend to rely on certain kinds of stars and certain kinds of supernovas. Hubble himself relied on Cepheid variable stars, which visibly pulse super consistently depending on their mass. We'll be coming back around to those later. For the past few decades, astronomers have also relied on the Hubble Space Telescope to study those standard candles at all distances across the sky. But the other camp in this cosmological crisis is relying on data from a different telescope entirely, studying light from a completely different point in history. The CMB camp derives their H-naught number from the oldest light in the universe, the cosmic microwave background. It was emitted just a few 100,000 years after the Big Bang, and our best view of it comes courtesy of the now defunct Planck Space Telescope. But a few 100,000 years after the Big Bang is over 13.6 billion years ago, and H-naught is the rate of expansion now. So these astronomers actually aren't directly calculating H-naught at all. Instead, they're creating computer simulations on the known laws of physics and their CMB data, and plugging in numbers for a bunch of different properties to try and recreate our universe. Alongside a bunch of other values like the abundance and type of dark matter in the universe, an H-naught value around 67 seems to work the best. So in a way, the Hubble tension represents just how well physicists understand the history and composition of the whole cosmos, or rather, don't. Because as is, the models are not predicting what astronomers are actually observing. With its superior resolution, the James Webb Space Telescope was supposed to provide more accurate observations, and therefore a more accurate distance ladder. And that extra accuracy would, hopefully, resolve this crisis. But in 2024, the first JWST results came in and sort of spawned a new crisis. Two research groups analyzed data from JWST and came to totally different conclusions about what it meant. And it's significant because both groups are hugely respected in their field, having produced gold standard distance ladder results before JWST came along. First is the team led by Dr. Adam Riess, who shared a Nobel Prize for discovering that the universe isn't just expanding, but expanding faster over time. In February 2024, their results were published in the Astrophysical Journal Letters. Their research analyzed over 1,000 Cepheid variables and concluded there was no significant difference between a Hubble and JWST-derived distance ladder. And with no new distance ladder, there was no new H-naught that would be closer to what the CMB models predict. Then, a couple of months later, veteran cosmologist Dr. Wendy Friedman presented her team's research at the annual American Physical Society meetup. They had compared Cepheid data with data from two other kinds of standard candle stars, meaning they had three kinds of standard candles that could be calibrated and cross-checked against each other. And after all that calibration, they calculated a new value for H-naught that agreed much more closely with the CMB camp. In other words, they were claiming that the Hubble tension had basically been solved. But come summer, Reese's team argued the results could be biased by the specific objects that Friedman and her team chose to include in their analysis, and which objects they did not. Now, this is still hot off the press drama. As of our recording, Friedman's results haven't made it through the peer review process yet. Meanwhile, Reese's criticisms have, but haven't actually been officially published. So the jury continues to be out when it comes to the latest results from JWST. But what does this bit of academic beef mean for now? Remember those error bars that don't overlap? Well, an error bar is only as good as your error accounting, and there's one type we need to acknowledge here. These are called systematic errors, small assumptions you make in your data processing that skew every number consistently in one direction. And everyone's numbers, be they be from Reese or Friedman or anyone else looking at standard candles or CMB models, involve a lot of assumptions about how the universe works, from how stars evolve to how subatomic particles really act. So most cosmologists believe that the Hubble tension is caused by some accounting trick gone wrong, some faulty assumption in the data pipeline that's messing up someone's results. But if Reese's team is right and the JWST can't produce an H-naught that's closer to the CMB predictions, it could mean that there's some new kind of physics to uncover. There are still a lot of cosmological mysteries out there, like why the universe is expanding faster and faster over time. Scientists blame dark energy, but no one really knows what it is. Right now, the strength of dark energy is considered to be a constant. It's one of the many variables that go into the CMB models that predict what H-naught should be. So instead of hinting at an accounting error, the Hubble tension could be showing us that dark energy actually varies in strength over time. If that's the case, it would be one of the biggest, most surprising new discoveries in physics in decades. But before anyone throws away their astro textbooks, we should wait for more data to come in. The JWST is only a couple of years into its fact-finding mission, so it may yet provide the data we need to solve the tension without invoking new laws of physics. Because despite their opposite conclusions, Reese and Friedman's teams have come to agree on at least one thing: the rung on the cosmic distance ladder that corresponds to nearby galaxies. So with a bit more back and forth, there might be more consensus on other rungs. But JWST isn't the only telescope that could help solve the crisis. By imaging the whole southern sky every few days, the upcoming Vera Rubin Observatory will be able to spot millions of supernovas, providing a more robust catalog of those standard candles. And gravitational wave detectors like LIGO could act as a sort of neutral third party in the debate, providing a completely different kind of dataset that astronomers could cross-reference against the CMB and standard candle data. So many cosmologists think it's only a matter of time before the tension is resolved, one way or the other. Whatever the solution ends up being, it's a nice reminder that our story of the cosmos is never finished being written, and that science is at its most vibrant when there are big mysteries to solve.